be done now.
Hi, everybody. This is Bob Gale, co-creator of Back to the Future, and you're listening to Brad Gilmore.
Doc! Doc!
Okay, relax, Doc. It's me. It's Martin.
Oh, it can't be. Just sent you back to the future.
Yeah. Oh, I know. He did send me back to the future, but I'm back. I'm back from the future.
Wait.
Wait a minute, Doc. Are you telling me that you built a time machine?
The way I see it, if you're going to build a time machine into a car, why not do it with some style?
Hello, everybody, and welcome to Back to the Future podcast, the only podcast looking back in time at the greatest film trilogy of all time, Back to the Future. I'm your friend of time, Brad Gilmore, and today on the show, we are going to be talking to Allison Robicelli. Allison Robicelli is the woman, the brain behind the Hill Valley Cookbook, the official Hill Valley Cookbook that came out, I think back in 2020 is when the book came out. And I will be honest with you, Allison and I, from the time the book was about to come out or around when it came out, we were on the phone with each other through Facebook. I was texting her, emailing. We were trying to set this up. And then, you know, life happens. As Jeff Goldblum said of the movie, life finds a way to get in the middle of everything. So we didn't have the opportunity to do the podcast back in 2020. And then for season 8, I was trying to do it. And things just kept coming up. And then finally, I told her, look, let's do it. And we had a date. And we were both excited about it. And then that date came. And and something didn't work out. I think I got COVID. I think this is what happened. I think I got COVID. Which I'm fine, by the way, if you're wondering. But this is my second bout with COVID, but I'm okay, all right? The wife and I got it, you know? She got it first and gave it to me. But these are minor details. I don't know why I'm sharing this right now. We talked with Allison about the cookbook. And here's the interesting thing. If you haven't gotten the Back to the Future cookbook, I suggest you go do so and have kind of use this podcast as a look-along or a read-along with the book, because she breaks it down from the 1980s to the 1880s to the 1950s to the 2015s to the alternate 1980s. And there's some really good stuff in here that she kind of gave insight on the ideas behind the dishes. And I really enjoyed it. We did have, at one point, I had her on via FaceTime audio, which I now have learned I probably won't do again. I like it because it has a little bit more of a clarity to it than, say, a regular landline or a phone call, but not as reliable. So there's a part where she was explaining her choices for the 1980s and the alternate 1980s and how she ran into Donald Trump, the former president of the United States, and the inspiration for the Biff character in the alternate 1985, she ran into him at some event, and that's when she started to cut out. So you'll hear a transition, and what that is I ended up just calling her on the phone, and we did the rest of the podcast like that. So just in case you're wondering, because there will be a part where I edit out as much as possible of it, but there are some choppy parts there around that story. But she saw Trump, and I think there was something to do with paparazzi or whatever. It was a long time ago, so just bear with me, okay? And if you haven't already, make sure you subscribe to this podcast. Make sure you give it a 5-star rating and review. I actually do read those reviews quite often on the Apple Podcasts. And if you have a review on there and I read it on the show, I'm going to send you a book in the mail. I've done it with a few people already. They can attest to it. It happens. I do it for real. For real, I do it. So I'm going to type in right now and see if there's any recent ones. I should have probably done this before doing the show. Let's see. Do we have a recent review? We do, from Wednesday. Was listening to Talk is Jericho the other day and found his episode interviewing Brad about his book and all this. It's awesome, and I am now listening to them all. That is from Iron Man 1986. Well, Iron Man 1986, if you are listening to this right now, shout out to you. Shout out to Chris Jericho. Slide in me DMs, my brother, on Twitter. I'm at Brad Gilmore, and I will send you an autographed copy of Back from the Future, a celebration of the greatest time travel story ever told, available in hardcover, paperback, and audio edition. You can get the audio CD. You can get it on Audible. read by my man Joe Himple, who I need to talk to on this podcast. Joe, if you're listening, I owe you a spot on this show. Without further ado, let's get to my interview with the author of the Back to the Future, the official Hill Valley cookbook, the incomparable, the greatest texter of all time, Allison Robicelli.
Listen, do you know where Riverside Drive is?
It's on the other end of town, a block past Maple, east end of town.
Well, not block past Maple, that's John F. Kennedy Drive.
Who the hell is John F. Kennedy?
And now for the next 30 minutes, as the world turns.
For viewers of the CBS soap opera, As the World Turns, first word came at about 1:40 p.m. Eastern time. It happened too quickly for cameras to be in place.
And I gave it a great deal of thought, Grandpa.
Here is a bulletin from CBS News. In Dallas, Texas, three shots were fired at President Kennedy's motorcade in downtown Dallas. The first reports say that President Kennedy has been seriously wounded by this shooting.
Then it was back to the soap opera, but not for long. Soon after, Walter Cronkite was back, reporting from the CBS newsroom, complete with rotary telephones and wire machines.
This picture has just been transmitted by wire. It is a picture taken just a moment or two before the incident. If you can zoom in with that camera, we can get a closer look at this picture.
And almost exactly 1 hour after his initial bulletin, this now famous announcement.
From Dallas, Texas, the flash, apparently official, President Kennedy died at 1 p.m. Central Standard Time, 2 o'clock Eastern Standard Time, some 38 minutes ago. Vice President Lyndon Johnson has left the hospital in Dallas, but we do not know to where he has proceeded. Presumably, he will be taking the oath of office shortly and become the 36th President of the United States.
On November the 22nd of 1963, President John Fitzgerald Kennedy, the 35th President of the United States, who was sworn into office less than 3 years earlier, was assassinated in Dallas, Texas by Lee Harvey Oswald from an upper window in the Texas School Book Depository building. President Kennedy was shot, as well was Governor Connally. President Kennedy was beloved by the majority of this country. He was a true rock star president. Shortly after his assassination, Lee Harvey Oswald went on to shoot Officer J.D. Tippit, went to hide in a movie theater, only to be captured by the Dallas Police Department and arrested for the murder of President Kennedy. Shortly thereafter, when transporting Lee Harvey Oswald for his arrest, a man by the name of Jack Ruby decided to take matters into his own hands with the presumed perpetrator of such an insanely tragic act. And on live television, he shot Lee Harvey Oswald.
Here he is. Here he comes.
Now the prisoner wearing a white sweater is changed from his t-shirt.
Let me have it. I want it.
Being let out by Captain Fritz. There is the prisoner. There is Lee.
He's been shot. He's been shot. Lee Oswald has been shot. There's a man with a gun. Absolute panic. Absolute panic here in the basement of Dallas Police Headquarters. Detectives have their guns drawn. There is no question about it. Oswald has been shot at point blank range, fired into his stomach.
He is shot.
He is shot.
Oswald,
it is Oswald.
Was that the man that shot the man, or do you know?
That is the man that shot the man.
There you hear the killing of Lee Oswald on live television back in November of 1963. Obviously, the assassination of President Kennedy is one of the most tragic moments in presidential United States history, and is something that people still talk about to this day. That is why in the movie Back to the Future, the joke was, who the hell is John F. Kennedy? Because little did the Baines family or any inhabitants of Hill Valley at the time know. Then in about 5 years and some change, or less than, that man who they have no idea of, the senator from Massachusetts, would be the next president of the United States, defeating Richard Milhouse Nixon in the 1960 election. Jack Ruby, Lee Oswald, and the assassination of JFK would go on to have several decades of conspiracy theories surrounding the murders, have books, films such as Oliver Stone's JFK made about these theories, and all looking for a reason as to why and how President Kennedy was killed on that day in Dallas, Texas. One man who, though, does sometimes get overlooked is Jack Ruby. Jack Ruby was a very complicated figure, and his story was explored by Dan Abrams. You might know Dan Abrams as a host of Live PD, and he also is a contributor to ABC News. He wrote a book called Kennedy's Avenger, which was about the trial of Jack Ruby after killing a man on live television. I got to speak to Dan Abrams about this, so I want to bring you that conversation right now so that we can help frame this narrative, this time capsule of 1963 when JFK was assassinated. And he joins me right now to talk about the new book, Kennedy's Avenger, Assassination Conspiracy and the Forgotten Trial of Jack Ruby. Mr. Dan Abrams joins us on the show. Dan, how are you doing, sir?
I'm great. Good to be with you.
I'm excited to talk to you because the Kennedy assassination, I'm not the only one, has been a point of fascination for me for the entirety of my life. But one of the guys, as you say, one of the forgotten members of that whole conspiracy, the whole story is Jack Ruby. Jack Ruby, of course, the man who killed Lee Harvey Oswald. So I guess why was Jack Ruby the person you wanted to really target for this project? And why was he such a point of fascination for you?
So my co-author and I, David Fisher, have written three other books about great forgotten trials involving presidents. And the first one was about a great murder case that Lincoln had argued 9 months before he got the Republican nomination. Theodore Roosevelt as the defendant in a case after he was president. John Adams representing the British soldiers. And, you know, we were sort of bouncing around some ideas and sort of talking about the Kennedy assassination. And you know, I'm the legal correspondent. I know I'm supposed to know all the legal stories, right? Start looking at each other. We're like, whatever happened with the Jack Ruby trial? And David and I are looking at each other. We're like, he was convicted, right? Of course. And so we're like, you know what? Let's dig in on this one a little bit. We both came back and we were like, oh my God, this story is so rich. This trial was so amazing. There were so many fascinating characters in this case, from the lawyer to celebrity witnesses, to a jailbreak, to the conspiracy theories that emerged from the trial. This is our next book. And the more we got into it, the more it was like, you know, even after the trial, you know, the investigations, Ruby taking a lie detector test, Ruby talking to the Chief Justice of the United States Supreme Court. The story was really, really rich, and we were surprised because so few people really know that much about the trial of Jack Ruby.
Yeah, I would venture, I guess, to say most people know little to nothing about the trial of Jack Ruby. His story really begins and ends in the American public consciousness on the 24th of November. That's the first that people hear right. about him, and it's really the last that people think of him. He's the guy who killed Kennedy. Yeah. That's seriously what his story is in history. So it's interesting that I heard you just characterize it as this fascinating trial full of all kinds of things going on. It was almost a celebrity trial of its time. And it made me kind of go back to the only point of reference that I have for a trial of this magnitude would be the trial of the century with O.J. Simpson, right? I mean, this celebrity trial, crazy things happening, evidence, all these theories.
And in that trial, the country was kind of split a lot. You know, half of them thought that OJ was innocent and he was still their hero. The other one thought that he was sure guilty and he was the villain of the story. How was Jack Ruby looked at by the American public? Was he looked at as a hero or was he looked at more like a villain?
Well, you know, it's a good question because that was the issue the defense had to grapple with. And I will tell you that in the early days, right, just after his arrest, I don't want to say that he was viewed as a hero, but there was a lot of sympathy and understanding for Jack Ruby. And that's the reason that it's surprising that he did not pursue a defense, which would have been what is called murder without malice. I mean, effectively, we call manslaughter these days.
Right.
But in the state of Texas at that time, the punishment for that crime was no more than 5 years in prison. Jack Ruby could have just said, yeah, I did it. I lost it. Because, you know, if you follow what Jack Ruby was doing that weekend, he was increasingly spiraling. You know, he's going in the middle of the night, going to take pictures of a billboard that he's convinced was the person who put it up, was somehow connected to the killing of Kennedy and this and that. And so, you know, there's definitely a very good argument that Ruby could have gotten this murder without malice. But instead, his lawyer named Melvin Belli was probably maybe the best known lawyer in the country at the time, decides he wants an all out acquittal. I'm going to be the lawyer who gets the guy who shot Oswald live on TV acquitted. And so he pursues this defense, which is effectively an insanity defense, that Ruby doesn't remember it happening, that he suffered an epileptic seizure, an epileptic event. He argued that he had a very rare form of epilepsy. And, you know, I think that lost a lot of the sympathy that was there for Ruby. Meaning, I think it became clear that there was a level of mental illness with Ruby, but to be acquitted on an insanity defense, it has to be more than just, you know, some level of mental illness. It has to be literally an inability to understand right from wrong. And in this case, the notion that somehow he didn't remember it happening.
Yeah, I wouldn't think that that would probably be the best path to take forward for a defense. But correct me if I'm wrong, Dan. So being Jack Ruby, dies an innocent man. His trial was overturned. What was the reason it was overturned? From what I understand, it had something to do with he had an oral confession to the murder in the police car, and that was deemed inadmissible. Is that right, or was there something else that got him off?
Yeah, so it was comments that he made to the police that they said he made, effectively suggesting that he had been thinking about this since the Friday before, you know, since the moment Kennedy was shot, which would show premeditation, right? But even though this was before the famous Miranda decision came out, there were still rules in the state of Texas basically saying that you can't start questioning someone who's in custody without a lawyer if it's beyond the incident itself occurring. Meaning like, you know, if in the moments after he shoots him, as many witnesses testified, he yelled USOB or et cetera, that's all admissible. But it's the comments made after that fact. And the court ruled that there was a statement in particular should not have been admitted. And they said that there should have been a change of venue out of Dallas for this trial. And so Jack Ruby got a new trial. And I think he was ready to pursue this other defense, which probably would have gotten him out with time served. That's the amazing thing. He'd already served 3.5 years in prison. If he had pursued this manslaughter defense, he would have, I think, gotten off by the end of the second trial, because even if he was convicted, he probably would have gotten time served.
I mean, it's incredible. It's incredible that wasn't the road that they pursued initially. As you said, it sounds like the lawyer kind of wanted to, he let his ego do some deciding for him.
Yeah.
Especially because how often, especially in the 1960s, did you get the crime on camera? It's not like today where everyone has a cell phone, but that actual crime was committed on camera and millions of people witnessed it. So I think that pursuing any other defense was kind of
silly. And the defense actually made an argument that no juror who saw the event should be able to be a juror because they were a witness to the crime. And so no witness to the crime should be allowed on the jury. And that was not an argument that ultimately was successful.
Now, you being a lover of all historical trials regarding the presidents, whether it be, you know, this Jack Ruby trial or other ones that you mentioned earlier, what was your assessment on the Jim Garrison trial in New Orleans against Clay Shaw? You know, that he was the only one to really bring a public trial against anyone for the assassination of President Kennedy. And he was kind of looked at as a kook. And even when you look at the characterization of him in Oliver Stone's film, sure, he comes off as a guy trying to fight for the right thing. But was he grasping at straws, or do you think there was any there?
No, I think he was a kook. And I think that Oliver Stone's movie was, you know, very misleading about what happened. I mean, the fact that he used Garrison, who was really, you know, I mean, you look at the coverage at the time from any sort of reputable entities, and, you know, he was viewed as really someone who was abusing his power back then. And, you know, the notion that somehow, you know, there was this grand conspiracy of all these people and to kill Kennedy. And look, and this gets into the bigger picture, because I think we should separate out, if we're going to talk about it, Oswald versus Ruby, right? I am convinced that Ruby could not have been part of a conspiracy. This idea that Ruby was hired as the guy to silence Oswald, right? The reason, just the easiest way to eliminate that is to say Ruby was there on the night that Oswald was arrested. Oswald came out. If Ruby was there to silence Oswald, you kill him on the night he's arrested. Instead, he doesn't kill him that night. He goes and he starts spiraling. And then on the Sunday, 2 days later, after Oswald has now had 2 days of questioning by the police, remember, the goal was to silence him. Ruby's the guy at the press conference that night on Friday night where the DA is talking about Oswald. And Ruby's raising his hand, correcting the language that the DA is using to describe what organization that Oswald was associated with. The hitman's going to start drawing attention to himself, correcting the DA's language about where what organization Oswald was with. And then on Sunday, the day that he was killed, the announcement had been that Oswald would be moved at 10 a.m. The media was all there. Everyone was ready for the big 10 a.m. moving from the police station to the jail. Ruby's basically waking up around this time. And he, an hour later, drives to, maybe let's say it's about 10:30, 10:45. He's driving to the Western Union to give $25 to a woman who works with him, who he has promised he would send money to. And he is there by happenstance, meaning the police station happens to be right down the block from the Western Union. And he gets a receipt, 11:17 a.m. So we're now an hour and 17 minutes after Ruby was supposed to be moved. And he saunters into the police station. And a minute later, Oswald is brought out. So if you just look at what happened Sunday, you have to believe, if you believe Ruby was part of a conspiracy, the police are in on it, right? It has to be. Has to be that the police are in on it.
Right.
And so it just doesn't, you know, it doesn't make sense. And look, there are other reasons as well, but that's separate from the question of Oswald. And I say it's separate because, you know, you can understand why Oswald, people suspected, was part of it. The guy lived in Russia.
Right. Revoked his U.S. citizenship.
Yeah. I mean, he moved out of the United States to go live in Russia. He was being questioned by the FBI. The CIA did have him on their radar, not for killing the president. But with all that said, I still don't believe the evidence is there that Oswald is part of a conspiracy. Because if he was part of a conspiracy, by the way, they did a really bad job of funding it, right? He has to get a ride to work that day. And the guy who gives him a ride talks about the long brown paper bag he's put over this thing that he said was curtain rods, right? It's the weapon. You're thinking, man, if this guy's being funded by the CIA or the Russians or the Cubans or whoever it is, maybe they get him a ride to work that day. so he doesn't have to bring the gun wrapped in brown paper bag to the office. And then the escape that Oswald has to make, he takes a public bus and then a taxi. And then he gets caught at a movie theater. I mean, it just doesn't make sense.
Yeah, when you lay it out that way, it would be hard to say that Jack Ruby was hired to silence him, especially with that 48-hour gap. Did they know each other at all? Because I've seen that characterization a lot, yeah, that they knew one another. Did they have any relationship at all?
There is no credible evidence that they knew each other at all. There were, there was a great anecdote from an illusionist who used to do a show at Ruby's club. And right after Ruby shoots Oswald, this guy makes a statement to a media entity basically saying he remembers Oswald from the club because he used to do a memory act, he said, and he remembered Oswald being there as one of the people he had to remember. And so then when the FBI catch up with him, he's like, well, you know, I don't really know if he was the guy. So suddenly the guy with the memory act doesn't remember. So that's the kind of, you know, evidence that there would be headlines, et cetera, that would suggest, oh, witnesses say they remember Ruby and Oswald. There is no credible evidence, in my view, that Ruby and Oswald knew each other at all.
So my last question for you, Dan, regarding this is I've heard you and other people characterize as Jack Ruby as someone who wasn't rather successful. He had some mafia ties, but, you know, really how much pull did he have? Probably little to none. Kind of a failed entrepreneur time and time again. But you name the book Kennedy's Avenger. And in today's world, with the popularity of the Marvel Cinematic Universe, that word Avenger carries a positive tone to it. You look at Avengers as heroes. Do you think Jack Ruby will be remembered as a Avenger in the characterization of Marvel as a hero? Or will he just be remembered as this guy who shot Oswald?
I think it's just going to be the guy who shot Oswald. You know, I don't think that Jack Ruby is a hero. And I don't think that he is going to go down as a hero. I mean, because even if you were so angry at Oswald, right? I mean, furious, as so many were, you still would rather, in retrospect, the guy have, you know, been put on trial. And that would have helped eliminate a lot of these conspiracy theories, by the way, because, you know, part of the reason so many of these conspiracy theories came up is because in the trial, there were so many unanswered questions. There were questions that were left sort of hanging in the air, like the one you asked. An FBI agent was asked at one point, did Oswald and Ruby know each other? Objection. Wasn't answered. Defense says to the prosecution, will you stipulate that Oswald acted alone? We're not stipulating to nothing.
Oh,
what does that mean? So the point is that a lot of that happened from the Ruby trial.
Wow. Yeah. Well, it's a fascinating book. I started reading it this morning. It is available everywhere right now. Kennedy's Avenger, Assassination Conspiracy and the Forgotten Trial of Jack Ruby. You can get it in audiobook form as well if you're one of the listeners like I am. Dan, thank you so much for taking the time. I could talk about the Kennedy assassination all day, but I really appreciate you making some time for us.
My pleasure. Thanks for having me.
All right. You have a good one. That is Dan Abrams, everybody. We'll be right back. There you heard about the case of Jack Ruby and Dan Abrams' opinions on the Oliver Stone film and what Jim Garrison did as the district attorney in New Orleans to put on the trial of Clay Shaw / Clay Bertrand. It was famously depicted by Tommy Lee Jones and Kevin Costner in the Oliver Stone classic, JFK. But again, this was such an important moment that changed how this country did business. It changed the direction of this country. And it led to the inauguration of Lyndon Baines Johnson, Lyndon B. Johnson, into the White House as the 36th president of the United States. And he eventually signed into law the Civil Rights Act and also helped launch the Johnson Space Center, which is here in Houston, Texas. And Kennedy wanted to go to the moon, and Johnson saw that promise out in 1969. Of course, we landed on the moon with Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin. But to me, when I was in the third grade, I was in Miss Moore's class at Poe Elementary School. And I remember
people coming to the door a lot, right? Like parents coming to the door a lot and wondering, like, what's going on? Why is everyone getting out of school early? I remember exactly where I was. I was in Ms. Moore's class. I was sitting next to a man named Marcel Hernandez. And we were wondering, what is this get out of early school early day or whatever? And that was the morning of September the 11th in 2001. And although I was very young, that moment is burned in my memory. And it was such a odd and strange time period in this country. And when I would ask my parents, have you ever lived through anything like this? Have you ever been through anything like this? They would talk about the Kennedy assassination. So my mom and dad were over at my wife and I's house for Mother's Day, and we started talking about Kennedy and talking about the assassination. And I said, guys, wait, can we go upstairs into my studio and can we talk about these on the mics? Because I wanted to hear, and I wanted you all to hear what it was like for people who were alive. And my dad was a senior in high school at the time. My mom was in the third or fourth grade. And so they're at different points in their life, but they still remember this day so vividly. And so I wanted to get them on the podcast. This is the first time my folks have ever been on anything that I've done, which I'm really excited about. But they're on this podcast. They're telling their story, what they remember about November the 22nd, 1963. We also talk about Back to the Future and their memories of it. And, to put in perspective, my mom and dad, my mom is in her late 60s. My dad's in his late 70s. And so they have really unique stories about that time and about the 1950s and the early 1960s and what that was like, what the world was like and how different it was back then. It was the first time I had guests in the studio. So the audio levels are good, but you know they could have been better. And in my headphones, I couldn't hear my mom. So you'll hear me tell my mom to speak in the microphone. And I promise you, I don't mean to sound like a movie director from Hollywood. I couldn't hear in my headsets, but when I listened to the audio back, she was plenty close to the microphone. But here are my folks. This is my dad, Burrel Gilmore, my mom, Marsha Gilmore, talking about that day in November of 1963 and what they remember here on Back to the Future, the podcast. I hope you enjoy it. And as promised, they're joining me right now in studio. The people responsible for bringing me into this world. The two people responsible for y'all listening to this podcast right now. Because if it wasn't for them, there would be no Back to the Future, the podcast. My mom and my dad, Butch and Marsha Gilmore. We call them Burrel. How are y'all?
Doing well.
Thank you.
All right. This is the first time y'all ever been on the air with me at all.
Correct.
That's correct.
How does that make you feel, Mom?
Oh, well, I'm always proud of you, Brad.
Oh, look at that. What about you?
Intimidated.
Okay. They're sitting here staring at me. They don't know what we're really talking about. But for this season, we wanted to talk about some things, you know, that happened historically, right? And one of the things that's always fascinated me is the John F. Kennedy assassination, JFK. And both of y'all, confirm or deny, were alive when Kennedy was assassinated.
Alive.
All right. And so it was the year 1963. Mom, what grade were you in 1963?
Fourth grade.
Fourth grade. Whose class was it?
Miss Martinez.
All right. Can you speak closer to the microphone?
Miss Martinez.
There you go. And what about you?
In high school.
Okay. And who was your class? What class? Do you remember who your high school teachers were?
Mr. Shepherd was one.
Okay. Now, here's the other fun thing. So in Back to the Future, you know, the way the movie came about was that Bob Gale, the guy who created it, was looking through his dad's yearbook, right? And he saw his dad was the president of his graduating class. Do either one of y'all remember who your class president was at Milby or Lamar High Schools?
No.
Nope.
No idea.
None.
Who were your best friends in high school? Dad?
Wayne Pitts.
And? Or was that your main best friend?
Henry Hall. Ronnie Murray.
Uh-huh.
David Brennick.
Okay, what about you, Mom?
Well, I don't remember last names for some reason.
Can you speak into the microphone?
Debbie, Stephanie, and Lisa.
Okay, look at that. All right, so let me ask you. I'm going to start, really, Dad, with you. So this is 1945 is when you were born. 1963 is when Kennedy was assassinated. So you're about 18 years old almost, right? Or you were 18 years
18.
Old. Okay, what do you remember the day? So here's why I think it's also significant is this happened in Texas, Kennedy did. You know, we live about 200 miles south of where this happened. So what do you remember about the day? When did you hear the news?
Well, I was working at a company called FedMart at the time.
And what was FedMart?
It was a Target at that time. They sold everything from dry goods to food to guns, ammo, and all that kind of stuff. So they were a full-service store at that time. And I was a checker at the time.
So you would do what? Like
check whatever they had, check it out.
So you're like the cashier?
Like a cashier.
Okay.
So we were in the middle of it, and all of a sudden our manager came over the intercom and told everybody, please be quiet for a minute. Everybody quieting down, the store quieting down. He said, just wanted to let us know that President Kennedy had been shot and killed in Dallas. And the whole store just stopped.
So what do you, because 18 years old, you know, it's not like you were like, I mean, you're aware, you're an adult, you know, I mean, you can vote for the president. So like, what was going through your head when you heard that?
Oh man, since Kennedy was so popular, I was wondering who would want to shoot him. You know, and why he came to Texas the way he did without his bowl on his limo.
And Mom, you were in what grade? Fourth?
Fourth grade, right.
So what do you remember? How were you told that Kennedy was assassinated? Because at fourth grade, like I remember, I was in third grade when 9/11 happened.
Mm-hmm.
And they didn't say anything to us that day.
Right.
We all went home. My grandparents picked me up. Your parents picked me up, right?
Mm-hmm, right.
And then the next day, they kind of set us all down. Miss Moore's third grade class and told us what happened. Right. So what happened with you?
So the teachers told us that we were going to stop, I guess, doing what activity we were doing at the time. And they said that the, I think it was the Houston Chronicle, that there was going to be an announcement and there was going to be reporters coming in our classroom and taking pictures of us, for this very important announcement or information, for lack of a better word, I guess. And they came in and told us that President Kennedy had been shot. And I remember gasps within our classroom from some of the students. And, you know, as much as I knew President Kennedy and I knew how much President Kennedy meant to my mom, I remember her voting for him. So I knew it was very important. I don't know that I understood
the ramifications of
it all at the time. But I just remember it was very, kids in our class were crying. And I just remember being, you know, sort of stunned, not sure what was going on. And they started they wanted to photograph our classroom as they told us. And then they posted that the next day in the paper, or maybe the same day. I don't remember.
Yeah, because Kennedy was killed at like 12:30.
Right.
So, I mean, it would have been middle of the day. That's why both y'all, you know, mm-hmm. were either at work or school.
Right, we were at school. Or I was, yeah.
So what do you remember their classroom reaction really being, though? I mean, everyone was like, wow, that's crazy. Because I remember, like, with 9/11, you know, we were like, wow, that's crazy. But, again, it's like it didn't really hit us, like, what, you know, what it meant or anything like that, was it?
Well, like I said, I mean, everyone, you know, it was sort of a gasp. And I remember the teacher was crying. Some students crying just hysterically. You know, they were so upset over it. I mean, this is fourth grade, so it made quite an impact on many of the students.
Yeah. And do you remember going home that night and like what your folks?
Yeah, and my mom was just beside herself over it.
She was crying?
Yeah, she was so upset over it. And that's all that, you know, they were glued to the television and that's all we watched to find out what happened. And you know, it was just devastating. My neighbors came out. I remember my parents talking to their neighbors and it was just a devastating time.
What about you, Dad? Like when you left, was it FedMart? When you left FedMart, you know, what do you remember after that?
During the time, the store just kind of shut down. Basically, we didn't close, but people just left their stuff in line and left and went home. And
so, like, you know, their groceries and their goods?
Left them in the bags, and they just
walked out.
Walked out, except for the ones that were in the process. But everybody was wondering, you know, that came through the, you know, the Cuban Missile Crisis and all that. And then to have him assassinated, I was wondering, man, we're in the Cold War with Russia and all that. What's going on?
Yeah.
So you might remember the Cuban Missile Crisis better than Mom would.
Right.
I mean, Kennedy was up for hours trying to avert
a
nuclear war that probably would have ended the world.
Probably.
So do you say, like, you being young, was Kennedy kind of like everybody's hero at the time? Was that like, that was the most popular person?
Most definitely.
Yeah. So, okay, when you left and went home after Fedmore, what do you remember? Do you remember talking to your mom or any of your family?
I talked to my mom, but she was glued to the TV like everybody was. So, well, I got in front of the TV trying to figure out what was going on, you know, how did it happen? You know, you're wondering how many shooters, you know, he was our president.
And just shocking.
They were shocking.
You said something about how many shooters. When did y'all first hear, like, you know, maybe this wasn't, you know, what they're telling us it was?
Almost immediately that afternoon, they were saying, you know, there were several shots fired. That was the first report.
Mm-hmm.
And so everybody's going, wow, was it just one person, two persons, five people? We didn't know. And I don't think anybody knew at the time. It was, you know, how the news gets. You get pieces here, pieces there, and somebody says something else. And so you really didn't know until a couple of days exactly how it went down.
A lot of rumors. Right?
So you remember rumors too?
Yeah, and I remember, you know, specifically, I remember when President Johnson was
sworn in on the plane
and in front of Jackie,
Kennedy,
you know, with the blood stains on her pink suit, and just, it was horrific. It was just a terrible, sad time.
So, you know, 10 years later, in 1973, so you're 28 and you're some 18.
18.
Right?
19. Yeah.
18, 19. Is when we first saw the Zapruder film, right? I mean, that's when it came out, 10 years after the fact, right? it's gruesome to watch. It's hard to watch, you know, that happened. But what do y'all think happened? Like, I know you've probably not spent, like, an extensive amount of time researching it, but, like, in your gut, Ma, you know, what do you think happened? Like, do you think that Lee Harvey Oswald acted alone and shot?
I doubt he acted alone. I think he was the fall guy for sure. But I'm fairly confident he didn't act alone.
Yeah, because you never know since Jack Ruby ended that.
Yeah,
so Jack Ruby was a guy who was in Dallas.
Exactly.
We're going to talk more about Jack Ruby later, but Jack Ruby was a guy who was in Dallas, had like loose mob connections, mm-hmm. is what people said. Mm-hmm. I think he ran like a strip club out there or a nightclub
ran
or something.
Several businesses in Dallas.
Okay, and he's a guy who, let's talk about that. So Lee Harvey Oswald's arrested. Everyone knows, okay, this is the guy they're saying killed the president, right? They get him in the movie theater in Dallas. He's being transported from the police station, I think, like, to the county jail or something like that. And it's on live television, right? Mm-hmm. Were y'all watching him be transported? Do you remember this?
Yeah, I do. Mm-hmm.
You remember it? Okay.
I remember it very well.
And on live TV, like, it's not crazy enough that the president was just killed the day prior or whatever. On live television, this guy, Jack Ruby, says, "Hey, Oswald," and runs up with a gun and shoots him and kills him on live TV.
And we were watching it live.
We were watching it.
Yeah, we were watching it live.
I watched it live.
And I just remember, like, more shock.
I mean, do you think that was when the rumors started coming? Like, oh, maybe?
Well, they want to know why. At the time, everybody was speculating. What are Jack Ruby's ties to the mob? Was this a mob hit? You know, because they were upset when JFK appointed his brother as attorney general.
And Bobby Kennedy, RFK, went after the mob pretty viciously.
Went after them real hard. And so they're trying to tie that in. And they were saying, why would the assassin of the president be assassinated a day later?
And so Jack Ruby kills him. There's conspiracy theories forever. President Johnson becomes the president of the United States. I mean, there's a lot of change. Did y'all notice, like, a change in society after Kennedy was killed? Was it a different world? Because, you know, like, after 9/11... it was different. The world was different, right? For a little while, everyone was nicer to each other, and like we were all like bound together
by
an American spirit of like it's us versus the world. We're gonna work together.
Yeah, it wasn't us versus us. Like it was. It is today with politics.
Yeah,
right.
And then you know the airports changed. You know the way that we thought about air travel changed. Right? So when Kennedy was killed, did y'all notice like any changes that happened? You know, in society at all?
It was probably, though, similar to after 9/11 because everyone kind of band together and everyone...
For a while they did. And, you know, it, of course, being in Texas, everybody liked the president and everybody liked the vice president.
Johnson was from Texas.
Johnson was from Texas. And
right.
He was from Johnson City.
Yeah, highly rated. And it was a time of turmoil. You just didn't know what really happened. Yeah. You didn't know if it was a mob hit, was a mob working for somebody else, was it an assassination from another country that was involved, and why. Just didn't know.
So the night before Kennedy was killed, though, he was in Houston. He was at Rice University giving a speech. Mm-hmm. Do y'all remember him being in town?
Yeah, I was at the stadium.
You were at the stadium?
Yep.
So what do you mean?
Well, when they were giving, he came in and they let a lot of the kids out of school and all that to go to see him.
Yeah.
And so you tried to get in the stadium to get to see him.
What stadium?
Was it
Rice?
Well, yeah, he spoke at Rice, I know. So maybe like with a football field there or something like that?
The whole Rice Stadium.
Uh-huh.
And a lot of people were there, but then everybody left early, you know, and hooked them with somewhere else. You got out of school.
So did you see him that day?
I saw him, but we were so far away, you don't know who he was, right?
Right. He was just a speck.
Yeah, it was a little guy.
It's always weird when the president's in town, right? Mm-hmm. You know, because I remember a couple of years ago, president came to town, and I remember seeing him on the freeway. We passed each other at the same time, and I could see in the beast in the limo.
Because we live out here by Ellington.
Right. And Ellington, so for people who don't know, Ellington's an airport here in Houston, not far from where we live, in a suburb of Houston. So going back to it, so Kennedy is assassinated. But so my dad, you were born in the 40s. My mom, it's not so polite to give a lady's age out, but you were born in the 50s. I hope you don't mind me saying. No. I think you've come to terms with it. You were born in the 50s.
I'm glad I'm still here.
Speaking of the mic.
Glad I'm still here.
There you go. What do you remember about the 1950s, Dad? Like, because you were growing up, like that was like all your adolescence, pretty much your early teen years was in the 1950s, right? So, what do you remember about the 50s? What was society like? You know, because now we got technology and social media and televisions everywhere. Like, what do you remember it being like?
Everybody's into Elvis back then, so.
You just remember Elvis playing,
sure that's what
would you go to like a drugstore is where you got, you know, there's like soda, right? Like soda jerks.
And my mom worked at a drugstore. So I'd go in there, you know, after school back then, get over in one of the paid telephone booths that used to stand and shut the door and read comic books.
You would read comic books in the telephone booth?
Uh-huh.
Like what would you read?
Anything that I hadn't read before.
Like what?
Oh gosh, I don't know, man. Superman was on back then.
You didn't read Archie.
I didn't read much of Archie.
That's me.
Archie comics.
Yeah.
So you just read comic. Were the comic books there? There was
two big stands.
Had racks
that
had,
of comic books had come in. So
they were all 25 cents each.
Yeah, you could just, since my mom worked, I just picked out one I hadn't read yet, and I sat there. And
So in the drugstore were the comic books, and then okay, you didn't bring them to the store
no, you had them.
That's cool. And so do you remember like milkmen and ice delivery guys and stuff like that? Was that big in the 50s still? Or
no, I don't remember that because I don't remember us having ice brought in. It seemed like I did in one of my aunt's houses. She did, but
I don't think we.
So there's a big joke in the movie of Back to the Future, right, where Marty goes back to the 50s and on like one of the marquees of the theater, Ronald Reagan was starring in a movie, right? Mm-hmm. And he's coming from a time where Ronald Reagan's the president, right? So when Ronald Reagan was elected president, because you were a big Western fan, do you remember him from the movies?
Yeah.
Ronald Reagan, did you ever see any of his movies?
Oh, yeah.
Like what movie? Do you remember a movie?
I don't remember the movie.
It was like Cattle Queen of Montana or something was a big one.
All that.
But was that like when he was elected, was it weird that the president was?
Well, everybody was wondering, man, a guy from Hollywood made it to the top.
Right, that of the White House.
Yeah.
Do you remember it being weird, Mom? Of like, here's this actor, and now he's the president?
I don't think I ever thought of it as being weird or anything, though. We liked him. We liked Ronald Reagan, so it was...
So, 1985, Back to the Future comes out. You've told me before y'all saw it in the theater.
Correct.
You went to the theater. Was it open? Do you remember if it was like opening weekend? Do you remember?
Oh, I don't remember.
Like July 4th weekend of 1985?
No, I don't remember that.
No?
Mm-mm.
Did you like the movie?
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, we liked it.
What did you like about it, Mom?
I think all the things that...
the going backwards going to the future and, yeah.
You know, are we going to have a hoverboard in the future and all that kind of stuff?
Yeah, I remember being weird.
Yeah, I'm like, are we going to...
Hoverboard and, yeah.
Oh, let me ask you that. Like, when you were growing up, like, what was the thing, you know, that you would see on TV or in a movie? Like, oh, well, they could never make that. Like, for instance... I remember watching a Bond movie or something, and he had a little screen where he was talking to talking to M or Q or whatever, and they were talking to each other through this video. And I was like, oh, we're never going to have that. That's crazy. Was there any, like, invention that you thought that we would have that came true?
The
Talk in the mic, Mom.
Get smart when he talked to his watch.
His shoe, right? Didn't he have a shoe phone?
His shoe. Dick Tracy did his watch. Yeah, Dick Tracy, that's right.
And now we actually have the watches you can talk into.
We can talk to, and yeah. Not, we don't talk to shoes, thank God, but, you know. I just thought that was pretty cool. And then here it is. Yeah. Well, actually, we never thought we'd have a phone that you could see people.
Right, that's what we have, right?
We were just, we just had regular basic telephones. Right, landlines, princess phones, and
what's a princess phone?
Wall phones, and huh?
What's a princess phone?
A princess phone was
the first one that came out. Had a light on it.
It had a light, and they came in colors like pink and turquoise. And
oh, so that was like a big deal.
Mostly girls like the princess phones, yeah.
Oh, okay.
And the dial was lit.
Yeah.
And that was pretty cool.
It's just so strange, right? Like where we've come to.
Yeah.
So Back to the Future, y'all liked it when you saw it.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. Who's your favorite character? Dan?
I like Marty.
Yeah, I would say Marty.
Yeah, no love for Doc? We're a big Doc fans
in
the side.
I like Doc too, but you said my favorite. I like Marty.
Well, you don't have to get hot about that. I'm just asking you a question.
I'm not getting hot about it.
You don't have to get mad at me.
A little minute.
Well, you know, I just, you know, I just thought it'd be cool to ask you all, like, you know, what happened with Kennedy and, you know, kind of get a real time capsule. Y'all were there. I've only been able to read about it.
Right.
You know? So to this day, you think that, to go back to it, there was a second shooter? You don't think that he was the single shooter?
I don't know.
I don't know that. I don't think he was. I think he was the fall guy, the person that maybe pulled the trigger, but I don't know that he, I mean, obviously he didn't. I don't think he planned it all himself.
Plenty
behind it.
But who knows?
We'll never know, right?
Never know.
You know, when I was in Dallas a few weeks ago and I went up to the Texas School Book Depository where it all happened, for my whole life I was thinking, oh, there's no way he can make that shot. No way. Like, mm-hmm. Through trees, a moving car, going away from him. Like, there's no way he can make that
but
shot.
Think how slow that car was
Well,
moving.
Then I got up to the floor and I looked through the window. Right. And I was like, oh, he could have totally made this shot.
Yeah.
Like, it's 100% conceivable that he did it by himself.
Yeah.
It doesn't make sense. There's some, like, I just wonder if it's one of the things that we say, well, I guess we don't want to believe that one person could affect the world like that.
Literally, right. Yeah.
You think that's why we have a conspiracy?
Probably. I don't think it's something we'll never know. You can think on it all any way you want to look at it, but I don't think any of us ever know exactly who was behind it.
Okay, here's my final question for you both. Y'all both will answer it independently, okay?
Oh, gosh.
If you had the DeLorean time machine, and you could travel anywhere, anytime, right? Are you going forward? Are you going backward? Where are you going, Mom?
I would go forward.
You go into the future?
Yeah.
How many years are we going?
Let's see. How old am I? So let's get out of, let's say 50 years. I would love to see what the world was like in 50 years. Just to know what in the world do they have now.
What happened?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, it would be incredible to know.
Yeah. What about you?
I'd go forward.
How far?
I'd probably like, Mom, go 50 years just to see what was going on.
I don't know that you ever want to go backwards because, you know, we've been there.
Done that. Yeah.
Yeah, you always want to go forward.
Well, yeah, but you haven't been to the 30s.
Yeah, but
or the 20s or the 1810s or the 1770s.
Yeah, I want to see what happens in the future.
Yeah, go forward.
You would never like go, like, okay, would you, if you had the opportunity, would you go back and change something in your life? Would you make a different decision?
I think the decisions you make are meant to be, you're supposed to make.
You agree with that?
Agree.
All right. Well, this has been my mom. Mom, thank you.
You're welcome, Brian.
We're doing this on Mother's Day, too.
I know. And it was a beautiful Mother's Day, and thank you for that.
Well, you're welcome. You're quite welcome. You deserve it. And this is my dad, Burrel E., Butch Gilmore. Dad, thanks for being on the show.
No problem.
All right. Look at that. We did it, guys. We did it. Well, I love you both dearly.
Love you too.
And we love you.
Thank you. The legacy of John F. Kennedy continues to be felt to this very day, and his assassination, although officially has been solved, I believe unofficially, we will always have questions on what happened on that day in November in Dallas, Texas.
I wanted to take you on this time capsule today because sometimes you have to know where you are, where you've been, and where you're going. And learning about the history of moments like this that have impacted and shifted American culture forever are important to learn. This is why the joke was funny in Back to the Future when he says, "Who the hell is John F. Kennedy?" Because the country had no idea the profound impact that one man would have on it in just a few short years. I hope you've enjoyed this time capsule edition of Back to the Future, the podcast. I want to thank Dan Abrams. I want to thank Burrel and Marsha Gilmore, my parents, for joining us today. And thank you all for listening. I know this is a different show than we normally do, but I had fun with this one. I'm such a history buff. So I hope you enjoyed it. Let me know what you think on the Twitter. Hit me up at Brad Gilmore. Make sure you rate, review, subscribe to the podcast on Apple Podcasts or Spotify, wherever you listen to your shows. And be back next week for another edition of Back to the Future, the podcast, here on Season 9 of the show. But until then, I'm your friend in time, Brad Gilmore. This is Back to the Future, the podcast. And I will see you in the future.